By now you're probably familiar with the mechanism as a sequence of irreducible chemical steps, and we call these irreducible chemical steps the elementary steps. Now let's consider a hypothetical process, A plus B goes to D. And let's say that we've hypothesized that the mechanism of this process occurs in two steps with the generation of an intermediate C. We can represent the process as occurring on a reaction coordinate or reaction profile diagram. And hopefully you've learned about these in the past as representing the energy progress of a reaction. So on the x-axis, we graph reaction progress, typically some bond angle or bond length. And on the y-axis, we graph free energy, and we watch the energy change as the reaction occurs. So as A and B go to the intermediate C, we pass through a transition state and then finally fall into another well, intermediate C. In step two, intermediate C must come out of its well and then fall down to the product D. Already from these reaction coordinate diagrams, we can see that we would expect the process to be exothermic overall. The transformation from A and B to D leads to an energy lowering, which means that we would expect the reaction to be exothermic. For each step of the reaction, we can ask two questions. The first is, how fast does the reaction proceed? And the second is, to what extent does the reaction proceed, or how much product do we form? The first question is one of kinetics, or reaction speed. And reaction speed is controlled by the energy difference between starting materials and transition state, or this energy difference here, often abbreviated as delta G double dagger. As a point of reference for you, a delta G double dagger of about 20 kilocalories per mole at 20 degrees C corresponds to a reaction half-life of about 20 seconds, meaning that we're about halfway to the establishment of equilibrium after about 20 seconds. As you can see from the graph here at left, as we increase the temperature, the delta G double dagger goes down. This leads to a decrease in the half-life and a quickening of the reaction, as you might expect. The issue of how much product is formed, or to what extent a reaction proceeds, is an issue of thermodynamics, and that's controlled by the energy difference between the starting materials and products. So you can imagine that if the reaction conditions were set up so that the reactants and products could both easily surmount the transition state, then we could quickly go back and forth from the starting materials to the products. And eventually, the more stable product, which is in this case D, would be formed in greater amounts than the less stable product C, and the energy difference between the two would be the controlling factor in terms of how much D is formed relative to C. What you're seeing here in the graph at left is the proportion of D in the reaction mixture as a function of the energy difference between the reactants and products, also known as delta G0 or delta G0. At negative values of delta G0, you can see that we have very high amounts of D in the reaction mixture, meaning that the reaction goes very favorably towards the products. This would be an example of a very exothermic reaction. On the other hand, if delta G is very large and positive, we see very little of the product form, and in fact, the starting materials are thermodynamically favored. They're lower in energy than the products. Thermodynamics and kinetics are a priori controlled by two different energy differences, and so they're completely unrelated on first principles. On the composite reaction profile, we can really see where thermodynamics and kinetics come into play. The thermodynamics of the reaction is controlled by the energy difference between A and B and D, the starting materials and products. The kinetic situation is slightly more complicated because we have two transition states to deal with. The transition state that really controls the speed of the reaction is the one at highest energy, and thus it's the transformation from C to D that's the rate determining step. This is the slow step of the reaction. You can think of it as if the equilibrium between A and B and C is well established before this conversion of C to D even starts taking place. The conversion of C to D is so slow that it's really this process that controls the speed of the reaction. In essence, C is serving as a bottleneck, and the conversion of C to D is the slow step. we talk about the molecularity of a reaction step as the number of molecules involved in its transition state. Thus, the molecularity of the first step, which involves two reactants combining into transition state 1, is a bimolecular step. However, the conversion of C to D, which involves only a derivative of molecule C in its transition state 2, is a unimolecular step. We see molecularity come up in the nomenclature for many elementary steps that you're familiar with, such as the SN2 reaction, which has a bimolecular transition state, and the E1 reaction, which has a unimolecular rate-determining transition state. We often talk about the molecularity of the rate-determining transition state because this influences the rate law, as we'll see in the next webcast. Hopefully, this webcast has shown you that given the energies of starting materials, transition states, and products, you can reason very profoundly about chemical reactions. But getting those energies in the first place is a matter of understanding the stability trends of intermediates and transition states, as we covered in the last webcast. This problem sort of brings it all together in asking you to determine what the reaction coordinate diagram will look like for a particular chemical reaction. This involves essentially two steps: figuring out the relative energies of the starting materials, transition state, and products, and then drawing that out on a reaction coordinate diagram. So in looking at this conversion of a thiolate to a thioether with displacement of a chloride, we see that this is probably an SN2 type process, strongly basic conditions with the thiolate present. And this would be a thermodynamically favorable process because the chloride is more stable than the thiolate anion. And to remember this, go back to the stability trends of anions covered in the last lesson. Thus, we can place the reactants at higher energy than the products, and then use the familiar picture of a one-step SN2 displacement to finish off the reaction coordinate diagram.